With the free version of Caltex, you can also make use of the storyboard function, which is very nice. The storyboard function helps you block shots, as they say, which means thinking about and deciding how would these scenes that you've written look like if you were to divide them up into different shots. If you're a writer who works with a production company, most likely a director or a storyboard artist is going to do that work for you, because you will most likely be busy writing. But maybe you are planning to do your own production, your own short, or whatever it might be, so let's look at what the storyboard function offers in terms of creating your own visual guide for shooting what you've written. In my opinion, the storyboard function in Caltex is not too extensive, but keep in mind that this is what is offered for free. You pay nothing for it. And when you just need a little help in staging some not too complicated scenes, production-wise speaking, it may be of great help. To get to the storyboard function, click on the project name so that Caltex brings you to the overview of the different functions within that project, where screenplay is one of them, and would give you access to the screenplay editor. This is the one you will probably use most, but this time we won't go into the screenplay editor, but rather to the storyboard function. Click on storyboard, and Caltex opens up a new tab. And what you see here is an empty canvas, so to speak, with a big plus that says add a shot. And that's what we're going to do. If you click that plus, Caltex adds a new shot here and it gets assigned the number 1.1 because it's the first shot in this sequence. Shots are ordered in sequences. The first number represents the sequence number and the second number represents the shot number within that sequence. We will look at adding sequences later on. First, let's see what we can do with this shot. At the top of the shot, you have a drop-down where you can select the type of shot, as in wide shot, close-up, etc. At the top right, if you click the cog icon, you can select between removing the shot or duplicating it in case you have a shot that has elements that you want to reuse in the next one. And then below, we have three areas: an image area, a shot blocker area, and a description area. In the image area, as you might assume, you can add an image the way you would usually do in Caltex. You click add an image and you're taken to the add image dialog where you can choose between uploading an image, selecting one from your library, or searching for one online, which you can then add to the library and use here in the storyboard. The description below is also relatively self-explaining. You put in what you deem necessary as additional description text in addition to what we're going to add as storyboard shot. And then the shot blocker. If you click Edit Shot Blocker, Caltex opens up a new tab, and here is where the real storyboarding takes place, if you will. What we have here is a canvas area where we can do our storyboarding. And for that, Caltex gives us ready-made objects that we can use. And by objects, I mean all kinds of things. If you take a look at the so-called palette menu below, where you see a bunch of people waiting to appear in your scene, if you click the right arrow, you see more of these people that you can choose from. And directly above, you see that characters is boldened because that's where we are right now. We are in the characters selection. But there are others to choose from. If you click through these other sections, people, animals, kitchen, and so on and so forth, you see different people and objects that you can choose from to put in your scene. You also have equipment like cameras, dollies, and more. So what you do is you just grab whatever elements you would like to use in your scene and you drag them to the canvas above, or you just click them and they will appear in the canvas. If you select them on the canvas, you see that Caltex gives you controls to manipulate that object that you added, because of course you will want to resize it and maybe also rotate it. So what you do is you use these little circles or handles to adjust the size and the rotation. To change the place where they are on the canvas, you just click drag them to another place and let go. In the lower left part of the screen, the select menu, you see additional options for the element that you have selected on the canvas. First of all, At the top, you have all the elements on the canvas listed, and you could select another one, or you can make sure that the right one is selected in case you have several elements overlapping each other, for example, and in the canvas itself, it might not be 100% clear which one the selection belongs to. Then below that, you get layer order control buttons. When you have several objects overlapping each other, you need to be able to define in which order they are stacked on top of each other. That's what you can do with these buttons. With up and down, you can move an element one layer up or down, and if you need to move an element several layers up or down, you can just click it several times. If you know that you want an element to be on the lowest lever, behind everything else, so to speak, or on the topmost layer, which would be in front of everything else, you can use these top and bottom buttons, which send the selected element directly to the top or the bottom layer. Then at the bottom, you have an orientation option. Depending on the object that you have selected on the canvas, you can select from different viewpoints here. For example, if you want to see a person or an object from different sides or from the top. In addition to the persons and objects you can choose from the palette menu at the bottom, you have some tools to choose from in the upper left above the canvas. The leftmost button is the selection mode. If that is activated, you can use the mouse pointer to select objects on the canvas just by single clicking on them. The other buttons are for creating certain things. The first one is for lines, the second for arrows, the third one for squares and rectangles, and the third one for circles and ellipses. The button most to the right lets you create text. The way it works is you just select the tool that you want to use, then click drag on the canvas to create the shape that you want to create, or in the case of text, you just click where you want to locate the text, and then once the object is created, you can select two colors in the lower left select menu. The color for the stroke or the border, if you will, and the color for the filling. If you don't want to see any stroke or any filling, there isn't really an option for that. But what you can do as a workaround is just select the background color instead, although this workaround doesn't work all the time. For example, if you would like to see what's behind the frame of a rectangle or a circle. But still, I think this shot blocker gives you a couple of very useful tools that let you create a simple storyboard very quickly and easily. And for sure, it's a lot better to have a quick and simple storyboard for free in a very short time than having to draw it all by hand, in case that's not your cup of tea, or having to hire a storyboard artist for that. Once you are satisfied with the result in the shot blocker, you just go back to the storyboard by clicking on the left arrow at the top left of the screen. Now, back in the storyboard, you see a little preview of what you just created in the shot blocker. One more thing, if you want to create more sequences in order to organize your shots, you use the plus button on the upper left, just above the sequences list on the left. Now, Caltex creates a second sequence, and there you can add more storyboard shots. As you can see, this sequence now starts the numbering with number 2. You could, for example, have one sequence of shots for every scene, and within that sequence you place all the necessary shots and angles for that specific scene. You can also switch the sequences around. Just grab one of them in the sequence list on the left and drag it to where you would like it to be. Caltex will then adapt the sequence numbering accordingly. If you want to remove a sequence, use the cog icon at the right edge of the sequence title bar and select Remove Sequence. Just be aware that this will also delete what is inside that sequence, and there is no undo function. So in case you have shots that you still want to use in other sequences, grab the shot you created with its number and drag it to another sequence. To print or download the storyboard you created, go to File, Print, / Download PDF. There you can select if you want Caltex to print the shot blocker and the image, or just one or the other. You can also select just to export a certain range of sequences instead of the whole storyboard. And then just click download and Celtex will save the storyboard you created as a PDF file. If you want to flip through your storyboard, so to speak, and just take a look at the succession of images or shot blocks, you can use Celtex built-in storyboard player. Go to View Storyboard Player and the player will open in a new tab. In the upper left, you see the number of the shot. In the upper right, you have two buttons. The first one controls the size of the picture and the second one toggles between showing the image or the shot block. At the bottom left, you can choose between three different speeds, and in the bottom right, you have play controls to play or pause or to jump back and forth between the different shots of your storyboard. This gives you the possibility to see a very rough version of your story, and it should give you a rough idea about if the order of your shots works.